So this is an example where we use the root stability criteria to determine the range of controller parameters to stabilize a process. Now this is typical for a cascade control system. Here you see that we have the primary process having a second order dynamics with a right half plane zero. We have the first order process with a time delay and a first order dynamics. For this case, we have a PI controller for the secondary loop and a proportional only controller for the primary loop. So the objective is to determine the range of the controller gain for which the process will be stable. Now, as you can see from this diagram, that the output is affected by both set point and the disturbance. So both regulatory and tracking control is involved. For the disturbance dynamics, we see that the pole has a value of negative 0.05. So having a negative pole, the output will be stable with change in the disturbance if the loop transfer function is stable. Okay, meaning that they will have the same characteristic equation, meaning the relation between Y and R and Y and D will have the same characteristic equation. So if we can show that the Y and R has a transfer function that has a characteristic equation that's stable, that will determine that the process will also be stable with respect to change in the disturbance. So to find the transfer function between the output and the set point, and to determine the range of Kc for which it will be stable, that's the objective here. And we can use the root stability analysis method to determine the range of Kc. Now to start with, we have learned about this four-step procedure to use the root criteria to analyze stability. The first step is to formulate the characteristic equation. So we'll go step by step. First, to obtain the characteristic equation, to find the transfer function between Y and R, we see that there are two loops here, the inner loop and the outer loop. So what we'll do first, we'll try to simplify this inner loop to represent it by one simple transfer function. To do so, if we look at the relation between WS and PS, we can simply use the relation that WS over PS, it will be all the transfer function between WS and PS, meaning this and this transfer function that goes in the numerator, and the denominator will be 1 plus all the transfer function in the loop, again the same two transfer function. And if we simply do some mathematical manipulation, we'll see that we'll get a simple first order model as this one. Okay, so we replace the inner loop by this closed loop transfer function to simplify the overall block diagram. And doing so, we get this diagram with that involves only one loop. Now we can find the relation between Y and R. Again, we follow the same procedure. The numerator gets all the transfer function between Y and R. So between Y and R, we have this transfer function, and this transfer function. So these three goes in the numerator. And then in the denominator, we have 1 plus all of the transfer function in the loop. So in the loop, what additional we have is this transfer function for this measurement device. So you see this 4 is not appearing in the numerator, it's appearing in the denominator. Simply, it does not appear anywhere between y and r. So again, if we simplify this equation, we'll end up getting this term in the numerator and the denominator. We have to simply multiply the overall thing by 9s squared plus 2.5s plus 1 times 6s plus 1. We end up getting the denominator to be this. Okay. So we have the characteristic equation we get by setting the denominator to 0, we get the characteristic equation. Okay. Now to express the characteristic equation to be applicable for the Ruth method, we need to express it into a polynomial form. We see that we have a time delay form here. So we need to approximate the time delay. So we can do it using the either using the Taylor series approximation or the Pardee approximation. We'll use here the Taylor series approximation up to the first term to get e to the negative 2s equals 1 minus 2s. And if we plug in this value, we end up getting the characteristic equation to be, you see that we have just replaced the time delay term by this polynomial term here. And if we further simplify this equation, we'll get the characteristic equation to be in the polynomial form of the decreasing order of s as this. We see that the first term here is already positive, so we don't need to multiply by negative 1. If it was negative, then we would have to multiply by negative 1 to get it, the first value to be positive. Okay. Now, we got the characteristic equation in the polynomial form. The second step is to check whether the necessary conditions is met. The necessary condition requires that all the coefficients should be positive. If not, the system is not stable. And if yes, we need to go to the next step. So we got the characteristic equation. We see that the first element, that's a positive number, so that's positive. And we need to have all of the coefficients to be positive. So the necessary condition is that all of these coefficients should be positive. To meet that requirement, we need this 24 plus 32 Kc to be greater than 0. This requires 32 Kc should be greater than negative 24, or Kc should be greater than negative 0.75. For the second coefficient, we'll need 8.5 minus 24 Kc to be greater than 0, or 24 Kc to be less than 8.5, or Kc should be less than 0.35. Okay, and the last coefficient, 1 plus 4 Kc should be again greater than 0. This requires that 4 Kc should be greater than negative 1, or Kc should be greater than negative 0.25. So these are the necessary conditions, that Kc should be greater than 0.25, it should be less than 0.35, and again it should be greater than negative 0.75. Next, so we see that the necessary conditions can be met. Next step will to formulate the Ruth array. So for the Ruth array, we'll have n plus 1 column, n plus 1 rows, meaning we'll have 4 rows, and n plus 1 over 2 columns, meaning 2 columns. So let's formulate the Ruth array then. So we'll have 1, 2, 3, 4 rows, and 1, 2 columns. So the first element, it directly goes to the first position here. Second element directly goes to the second position here. The third element again comes to the first row to the second column. So and this fourth element again goes to the second row, second column. So 1 plus 4 k c. Now so the first element in the third row, in the denominator it will be this term 24 plus 32 k c. In the numerator it will be this time this minus this time this. Okay. So 24 kc, 24 plus 32 kc times 8.5 minus 24 kc minus 54 times 1 plus 4 kc. And the second element, there is nothing here, so it should be 0. Okay. In the fourth column, you see this element is 0. So in the denominator, it will be this entire term B1. Okay. And then on the numerator, it will be B1 times 1 plus 4kc minus this element times 0. So it's 0. So you see that B1 gets cancelled out, so it should be simply 1 plus 4kc. Now to analyze the stability, we have to have all the elements in the first column to be positive. The requirement is that all of the elements in the first column should be greater than 0. Now the first element being a positive number, it's always greater than 0. We see the requirement will be these three elements be greater than 0. And to meet this requirement, we'll have 24 plus 32 kc greater than 0. That will be one that we got as the necessary condition. So kc should be greater than negative 0.75. So also you see the last element is also the common with the necessary condition. So that will give us kc should be greater than negative 0.25. Okay. Now to deal with this element here, we see that this entire thing should be greater than 0. So this individually, this term should be greater than 0. So if the numerator term is greater than 0, so that satisfies the requirement. So we'll have 24 plus 32 kc times 8.5 minus 24 kc minus this 54 times 1 plus 4kc, that should be greater than 0. So that's the requirement. So if we simplify this, we'll end up getting 384 kc squared minus 260 kc plus 75, that should be greater than 0. Okay. Now if we look at this function, this is a quadratic function in kc. So a quadratic function with a positive coefficient would simply go in the positive direction and intersecting the x-axis at two points. Now if you plot this function, it will look like something like this. It has got two roots being a quadratic equation. You see that these two roots will be, one is negative 0.896 and the positive root is 0.218. Okay. What does simply mean that between these two values, the function will be greater than 0. So the limit of kc for which this element will have a value greater than 0, it's bounded by its roots. So kc should be greater than negative 0.896 and kc should be less than 0.218. So these
2 along with these 2 formulates the requirement for the sufficient condition. Now, to think about a little bit that the sufficient condition should also include the necessary condition, because the sufficient condition is by itself, it's mean by sufficient and necessary. So you see that Kc being less than 0.218 will fulfill the condition that Kc being less than 0.35. So if the sufficient condition is met, the necessary condition is also met. Also, you see that these two conditions are same as the necessary conditions. So if all of these 4 sufficient conditions are met, the necessary condition will also be met. So you see that the necessary condition requires that Kc should be greater than negative 0.75, it should be less than 0.35, and it should be greater than negative 0.25. and the sufficient conditions require that it should be greater than negative 0.75, it should be greater than negative 0.25, it should be greater than negative 0.9, and it should be less than positive 0.21. now if you try to see all of these values on an axis, so we have this three negative values, and Kc should be greater than these 3 values, and we have these 2 positive values, and then Kc should be less than those 2 positive values. Now if we have 3 numbers and the variable needs to be greater than all 3, so if the variable is greater than the largest number, then that meets all the requirement, meaning that if it's greater than the largest number, so it should be also greater than the other numbers. In the same way, for these 2 positive numbers, it requires that the variable should be less than these 2 numbers. So if it's less than the smallest number, then it should meet the requirement that it's smaller than both of these numbers. So we see that the range of Kc here, if it meets the requirement that it's greater than the largest of these 3 and is smaller than the smallest of these 2, then it will meet all the requirements. So we have the range of Kc to be negative 0.25 to positive 0.21.